now, the end is here, and so I face my final curtain. My friends, I say it clear, I state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, 'cause I've traveled it, and every highway, what more, much more than this, did it God's way. Regrets, 'cause I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention, 'cause I did what I to do, and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along those byways. Oh no. Oh no, not me. I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you all knew, when he bit off more than he could chew. But through it all, there were doubts, he ate it up and spit it out. He faced it all and he stood tall and did it. I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think Tulloch, you did all that. And may I say, not in a shy way, oh no, oh no, not me, I did it my way. For what is a man, what has he got, if not himself, oh, then he's not, to say the things that he truly feels, and not the words of one who needs. The record show, sir, you took your blow. It was mine and God's way. All my life you have been faithful.
Destiny. Beloved in Christ, good morning and peace be with all of you. It is indeed an honor for me this morning as Rector of the Blessed Sacrament Cathedral to extend welcome to each and every one of you present here this morning at the Blessed Sacrament Cathedral in Montego Bay, as we come to give praise, honor, and glory to our God for the official memorial Thanksgiving Mass of our dear brother Francis Anthony Tulloch. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We rejoice and are glad because as Christians, we know and believe that a brother of ours who is so faithful and a good Christian in his life has returned to his God and our God. And with that, we acknowledge and say, praise the Lord. So, this morning, let us extend these words of welcome. I want to begin especially as we gather here to the dignitaries that are present here on this occasion. The Bishop, Honorable Conrad Pekin, Custos Rotulorum of St. James, representing the Governor General, His Excellency, the Most Honorable Sir Patrick Allen. Welcome, sir. The Minister of State in the office of the Prime Minister and Member of Parliament, the Honorable Omar Davis, representing the Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Andrew Olmos. Welcome, sir. Members of the Parliament, Mr. Philip Polwell, representing the Leader of the Opposition, Mr. Mark Golding. Senator Janice Allen, members of the House of Parliament, Chief Technical Director, Mr. David Dobson, representing the Ministry of Tourism, the former ministerial and political colleagues of our brother Francis. I also take the opportunity to recognize all the dignitaries and officials who have joined us virtually this morning, wherever they are. Next, I would like to extend and welcome our chief celebrant this morning, the Most Reverend Birchall MacPherson, Bishop of the Diocese of Montego Bay. We are great that we can have him present with us despite his physical health. Welcome, Bishop. The brother priests and brother deacons that are present, members of the clergy, joining Bishop Birchall for this occasion. And on extend, welcome to the beloved bereaved family, Honorable Sister Mrs. Frances Tulloch, members of the family, friends and relatives. Welcome. As we will continue with these proceedings this morning, just want to let us know, as we keep on with the programs, I would propose the understanding that it will not be necessary for further formal salutations to be interjected in the order of service. So now, I will introduce to you the order of service as we begin with the tributes. This morning, the tributes will be given by the Most Honorable P.J. Patterson, O.N.O.C.C.C.C., former Prime Minister of Jamaica. Next, representing Honorable Edmund Barrett, Minister of Tourism, Mr. David Dobson, Chief Technical Director, Ministry of Tourism, followed by Dr. Wickham McNeil, CD, former Minister of Tourism. Then we'll have the representative of the Russian Embassy also present here this morning. And we'll have Deacon Espute. Then conclude with the remembrance by Mr. Clayton Morden. Beloved in Christ, after I leave this podium, we'll proceed with the tributes. It is our prayer together that we are here in this occasion. As I said in the beginning, I want to repeat it again. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. A faithful brother of ours, Brother Francis Anthony Tulloch, has returned to his God and our God. We pray for the spiritual and peaceful celebration, especially to the beloved family members. Thank you and welcome, welcome.
With the passing of my dear friend and close colleague, we have lost a venerable stalwart and deprived of a warrior whose life was devoted to the articulation of the concerns of people and to their effective representation in the halls of power, regardless of their social status or political affiliation. It speaks volumes about the qualities and dedication of Francis Anthony Tulloch, who was born, schooled, and reared in Kingston City, that he would, to the very end, be regarded as a man of the West. This was because he became so engrossed in advancing their cause and welfare that the younger generation would never realize that he was not an original native Bay boy, but actually belonged to a family in the capital city. From his earliest days at St. George's, this tall, erect, handsome, and bright schoolboy was the acknowledged go-to lad. Whether as a debater or an attractive sunlight batsman, he exuded elegance and the capacity to persuade the many whose attention he readily commanded. He was blessed in abundance with the gift of charm. His scholarly discipline, brilliant eloquence, and innate passion for fairness, for what was right and proper, impelled him to embark on a career in law. Having gained his legal education in London and called to the bar at the prestigious Lincoln's Inn, he returned to Jamaica anxious to play a role in the new Jamaica that was emerging and to utilize his legal skills for social transformation. Deeply frustrated by what he saw then, he was persuaded by Dudley Thompson to join the legal chambers of a Caribbean legal and political luminary, Sir Lindley Pindling, who was ascending to the high office of Prime Minister of the Bahamas. But boiling within him was that inner fire for active political engagement in his homeland. And so, no longer content to remain on the fringe of political activism in the Bahamas, Francis decided to return home. We met frequently, often on the same side, in the courts, and the fine advocate was making his own impressive mark when, to the surprise of us all, he elected to set up his legal practice in Montego Bay. At that time in our legal history, it bordered on professional suicide for a barrister at law to move so far away from the seat of the Supreme Court and Court of Appeal. Moreover, he was warned about the dangers of getting a decent share of legal work for one who had no previous connection with what still called itself the Second City. It seemed risky to throw himself at the economic mercy of citizens who were fiercely territorial and still prone to repeated declarations of being a republic. Francis could not be dissuaded. Before we knew it, he arrived in Mobay and settled down to prove his legal competence. In quick time, he was fully accepted by everyone. He came, he saw, he conquered. Soon his outreach extended well beyond the courts, and he began to attract broad political support. He defeated all political odds to emerge as the indisputable leader of Central St. James and emerged as the popular choice to compete electorally against a favored son of the soil and formidable opponent, Tony Hart. What a glorious campaign led by Michael Manley, it proved to be. Little David was victorious as his love, genuine desire to uplift the poor and care for the disadvantaged shone brightly in everything he said and wherever he walked. Everywhere he went, he exuded sympathy and earned admiration, listening to everyone with amazing grace and relating to their plight with generous consideration. Comrade Tulloch proved time and time again that he was no ordinary politician. There is no one else who spanned the wide expanse of electoral geography that Francis Tulloch achieved in his time at the political wicket. 4 constituencies in 2 parishes. That is a political record. As Member of Parliament for Central St. James between 1972 to 1976, Francis served communities stretching from Spot Valley in the east to Reading in the west and parts of Cambridge in the south, giving him the kind of reach that would help to cement his place in the hearts and minds of the people of Western Jamaica. He was a staunch advocate for education, and his maiden term was crowned with achievements, including the construction of the Montego Bay Community College in 1975, Herbert Morrison Comprehensive High in 1976, and Cambridge Secondary School, now Cambridge High School. He went on to provide parliamentary representation of the highest caliber to the people of West Central St. James between 1976 and 1980. In Eastern Hanover between 1993 and 1997, and Northwest St. James from 1997 to 2002. He was elected as a vice president of the People's National Party and was always in high demand as a speaker on the political platform. Over the years, he served different periods of impressive ministerial apprenticeship in the ministries of labor, then of transport, and of tourism. I appointed him Minister of Tourism in 1997. Knowing full well of his insistence on inclusiveness of the marginalized with meaningful development of the hospitality product. For him, there could be no real development of tourism without the integral involvement of tangible benefits for the people, whom he was convinced should always be at the center of the development process. His relentless advocacy for people-focused tourism led to the formation of institutions like the Jamaica Union of Travelers Association, JUTA, and the Jamaica Cooperative Automobile and Limousine Tours Limited. The refurbishing of craft markets, as well as small attractions, and their inclusion as priority stops in tour itineraries was a hallmark of his tenure as tourism minister. Francis Tulloch practiced what he preached. He was involved in tourism development not only from a policy perspective, but as a small entrepreneur, creating and operating the Great River Rafting and Plantation Tour at Lethe on the St. James-Hanover border. The lush vegetation and salubrious environment of Lethe was his home and his fountain of peace and tranquility, which he shared with his wife, his family, and clientele. In the twilight of his career, he embraced the Catholic tradition of St. Francis Xavier by fulfilling the promise of his Christian nurturing from the Jesuits at St. George's. In that dispensation, he found peace in ministering to the poor, the sick, the elderly, as a deacon of the Roman Catholic Church. Francis Tulloch has passed from this earth, but his numerous contributions to building a better Jamaica are timeless, and his enormous legacy of social, economic, and political development will abide the most exacting tests of time. I again express heartfelt condolences to his family, to his dear wife Doreen, and all his loving children. May the soul of this true Jamaican servant now rest in eternal peace. The earthly sojourn of Francis Tulloch has ended, but the redeeming glory of his exemplary humanity will never be forgotten. Oh, I still feel you here with me. You're more than just a memory. Oh, you will never be forgotten.
Good morning, everyone. Please allow me to express condolences to the bereaved family on behalf of Minister of Tourism, the Honorable Edmund Bartlett, and the Permanent Secretary, Ms. Jennifer Griffith, who regrettably are unavoidably absent today. It is, however, my pleasure to present a tribute on behalf of Minister Bartlett and the tourism family. In paying tribute to the late Francis Anthony Tulloch, I do so recognizing his tremendous contribution to our country as a former parliamentarian and one of my predecessors as Minister of Tourism. I want to first recognize the fact that for him to have given up what I understand was a lucrative law practice in the Bahamas to return home to serve his country was truly an act of patriotism. The people of St. James in particular benefited from his legal knowledge, and later they and the people of Hanover Eastern had the benefit of his political representation in Parliament as well. It was, however, for his contribution to national development, especially through tourism, that he will be remembered most. Mr. Tulloch not only made his mark in tourism publicly at the policy level, but privately as an entrepreneur. This, of course, you would have heard from former Prime Minister, Mr. Patterson. He was a true stalwart who played an integral role in developing the tourism sector, and the industry has profited significantly from his contribution, particularly with his support for the development of the Master Plan for Sustainable Development and his concern for traders in the craft sector, ground transportation operators, and small entrepreneurs in industry. He, along with his wife, Doreen, made their mark as investors in the tourism with the development of rafting in Leyte, operation of Mountain Valley Hotel, and a garden tour. They offered a good example of community tourism, as members of the Leyte area and surrounding communities were able to benefit directly from the circulation of tourism dollars among them, especially on days when cruise ships docked in Montego Bay and busloads of passengers chose the rafting attraction. Although during his years in government, he served other sectors, undoubtedly he developed a passion for tourism, which was evidenced during his tenure as Minister of State and later Minister of Tourism. On a personal note, Mr. Tulloch was always one with whom it was easy to maintain cordial and respectful relations, transcending the partisan divide. He was always open to listening to other points of view and had a conciliatory attitude that allowed for a harmonious relationship. It is no wonder that when he decided that the time had come to leave the cut and thrust of politics behind, that he opted for the Christian ministry and was ordained a deacon in the Roman Catholic Church, to which he was a devoted member to the very end. He earned another feather in his cap for public service when he joined the diplomatic service as the first honorary consul of the Russian Federation in Montego Bay, incorporating the parishes of Trelawney, St. James, Hanover, and Westmoreland. That effectively put him back in tourism, as he was now the diplomatic link between the Jamaica and the growing number of Russian visitors and those who had made Jamaica their home. Our research revealed that at his formal introduction to Western Jamaica in 2014 as a diplomat, then Russian ambassador to Jamaica, Vladimir Polonev, saw Mr. Tulloch's appointment as a tangible and significant sign of Russia's readiness to actively develop bilateral ties with Jamaica in the fields of tourism, economics, and culture, and to steadily strengthen the relationship between Russia and Jamaica. There is no doubt that the name Francis Tulloch will resonate in the halls of Parliament, and his chosen political party, but especially in the hearts of the thousands of Jamaicans whom he diligently served directly and indirectly during the various phases of his life. As Minister of Tourism and a Member of Parliament in the parish that benefited most from his life in public service, I want to say thanks to Mr. Francis Tulloch for giving limitlessly to his country, especially at a time when the mood of many Jamaicans was to look north. He will be sadly missed, and none will miss him more than his family. On behalf of the entire team within the Ministry of Tourism and its public bodies, which he served, as well as the wider tourism fraternity, again, I would like to extend sincere condolences to Mr. Tulloch's family. To Doreen and children, I wish for you comfort in those times when you need it most. Those times when the reality of dawns that he's not physically with us anymore, but is now in a better place. May his soul rest in peace and light perpetual shine on him. Thank you.
You ever know that you're my hero? And everything I would like to be, I can fly higher than an eagle. You as the wind beneath my wing.
Members of the officiating clergy, members of the bereaved family, members of the congregation, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. There's a saying by Rudyard Kipling, if you can walk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings nor lose the common touch, if neither foes nor loving friends can hurt you, if all men count with you but none too much, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it. And which is more, you'll be a man, my son. This quote embodies Francis Anthony Tulloch. Francis was a colleague, an advisor, a comrade, a mentor, and above all, a good friend to me. I knew Francis most of my adult life, but our relationship strengthened when I went into representational politics in 1997 and became an active member of Region 6. Francis was already a legend by this time. Arguably, having the distinct record of serving as Member of Parliament for more constituencies than anybody ever had and maybe ever will in our region. There's a reason for this. In my estimation, he was arguably one of the most popular politicians that the West had seen and was always in demand. So every time he stepped away from elective politics, a new constituency would come and beg him to run. And being Francis, he would agree. So he ended up being Member of Parliament for Central St. James, West Central St. James, Northwest St. James, and not to be parochial, Eastern Hanover. I'm guilty of calling on him in 2007 to return to West Central St. James, which would have further solidified his record, but alas, we were not successful. Francis's popularity did not just come from the fact that he was tall, bright, charismatic, and a great platform speaker. It was because he truly cared for people, and the people knew it. Francis was a socialist at heart and embodied the philosophy of our party. He truly believed in equality for all and made it his mission in life, whether as a lawyer, a member of parliament, a minister, or deacon of the church, to defend and uplift the lives of the poor and less fortunate. In the year 2000, myself and former Prime Minister Portia Simpson Miller were assigned to the Ministry of Tourism. This was immediately after Francis had left due to ill health. There were a number of things that we were able to inherit from his tenure that helped to transform the tourism landscape as we see it now. Two things stand out. The first is his work on the Tourism Master Plan for Sustainable Development. While Portia and myself may have completed it and signed off on it, it was Francis who initially went to the Commonwealth Secretariat and secured the funding and services of a consultant to develop it in the first place. The second was the preliminary work he did alongside Dr. Paul Robertson of blessed memory to market Jamaica and Spain as a place for investment. These efforts culminated with the opening of the first Rio Hotel in 2001. And heralded the beginning of a wave of Spanish investments in our tourism sector that brought thousands of new rooms to our island. But he had challenging times too. And in those times, Francis could be relied on to use his experience and eloquence to serve Jamaica well. And we all know he had a way with words. In 1999, Jamaica was rocked by the gas riots, which obviously affected our tourism industry. Francis, who was still Minister of Tourism, went to New York to speak to the overseas media, and they asked him to explain the cause of the gas riots. His reply was a classic. He told them, and I quote, "The British left us a great thing called democracy. Our government decided to increase the gas tax by 30%. The people disagreed. Democracy prevailed. I think it is something for us to be proud of, that when our people spoke, we listened." This was classic Francis Tulloch. But I suspect that if you were to ask Francis what were his greatest accomplishments, those traced to his heart, it would be the work that he did to ensure that the small entrepreneurs in the tourism sector, the red caps, transport sector, and craft traders, many of whom he continued to represent long after exiting the political arena and the Ministry of Tourism, were able to get a bigger piece of the tourism pie. But above all, Francis was an independent spirit. He believed in what he believed in and was never afraid to articulate those beliefs, no matter the consequences. Shortly after I became minister in 2012, long after Francis had become a deacon in the Catholic Church to which he was devoted, I awoke to a headline in the Gleaner which said, "Catholic deacon bats for casino gambling." I had no doubt who that was. He did go on to say that his view was not that of his church, and while I may have enjoyed the support, it could not have made him many friends the following Sunday. When all is said and done, my life was enriched by knowing Francis. Jamaica and the People's National Party were better for having him as a nationalist and true patriot. He has gone now to join his colleagues in Region 6, especially Roger and DK, All three of them were born in 1940. Many of you here from the West will remember in 2010, we had a birthday party. It was their 70th birthday. We had a birthday party, and the three of them were there, Roger, DK, and Francis. And DK insisted on speaking for the three of them because, as he said, he was the youngest of the oldest. I am sure that they're up there somewhere having a drink and reminiscing on the good times. Thank you, Doreen and the family, for having shared him with us. Jamaica has lost a great defender of the people. May his soul rest in peace and light perpetual shine upon him. Thank you.
I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eyes on the sparrow, and I know he watches me.
Dear Mrs. Tulloch, members of family, respected attendees, good morning. On behalf of the Ambassador of the Russian Federation to Jamaica, His Excellency Mr. Sergei Petrovich, and on my own behalf, let me say some words about untimely deceased Mr. Francis Tulloch. Mr. Tulloch was one of those persons about whom it is safe to say that he was a worthy son of his country. As it was mentioned, in 2014, he accepted the offer of Russian embassy and became our honorary consul in Montego Bay. During his tenure, he did a lot to strengthen ties between Russia and Jamaica, especially in the touristic sphere. In 2018, when our two countries signed the visa waiver agreement, it was Mr. Tulloch who was on the front line, because namely Montego Bay, which is the second largest city on the island, was the city to which the increased stream of tourists from Russia went. We thank him for these 7 years of work as honorary consul of the Russian Federation, for his outstanding efforts for the benefit of people of the two countries. And no doubt, his name will remain in our hearts. As we say in Russia, rest in heaven's kingdom. Thank you.
This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
I have been asked to read this statement, this tribute to Deacon Francis Tulloch by the bishop who ordained him, the Most Reverend and Honorable Charles Dufour, former bishop of Montego Bay. Francis Tulloch was no ordinary man, and despite being known as Little David in the political arena, he was a giant who possessed extraordinary qualities as a human being. He was a man of integrity, a man of service, a man committed to family, a man committed to his country, and most of all, a man committed to his faith, particularly in the latter decades of his life. These qualities endeared him to people from all walks of life, including both sides of the political aisle. It is not difficult to conclude that he must have been driven by a force that propelled him into service in almost every facet of his life, whether it be personal, familial, business, constituency, or church. So, what fuels such a tenacious and persevering spirit to continuously and consistently offer himself to a life of public service at the highest level? What propelled him to offer himself to serve the church, evangelizing with so much, if not more, fervor and passion as when he was on the campaign trail? Clearly, Francis's delight in serving was ignited by his unwavering Catholic faith. His faith called him to feed the poor, to care for the less fortunate, to shelter the homeless, to educate young people, and preach the word. As a servant of the Lord, Francis exemplified gospel values and the drive to show Christianity in action in all his dealings. Francis often talked about how the influence of the Jesuit priests at his alma mater, St. George's College, firmly cemented his faith, so that even when contemplating agnosticism while studying abroad, he did not waver. "It was my honor," says Bishop Charles, "to help him discern the call to become a deacon in the Roman Catholic Church and to serve the people of God in this ministry. He and Doreen formed deep bonds with the other deacon candidates and their wives. These bonds exist even in his passing, for we believe in the communion of the saints. I was proud," says Bishop Charles, "to ordain him to the diaconate in the Diocese of Montego Bay on November 7th, 2009. As a deacon, he understood very well what it means to be a servant leader, and his dedication and inspired actions helped to expand and build up a vibrant community at the St. Mary's Catholic Church and Basic School in Cambridge, St. James. His service impacted many other rural areas in the parish. Deacon Tuller was a man after God's own heart, who our Lord Jesus Christ used as an oracle and a channel of his peace and love. A man whose philanthropy was immeasurable. His legacy will live on, especially throughout the length and breadth of Western Jamaica. I shall surely miss my friend and fellow servant, Deacon Francis, and I mourn with all who loved and were touched by him. I am comforted that in mourning, we do not mourn as those who have no hope. Rather, we mourn but are filled with expectant joy that our brother, our friend, our deacon is resting in the arms of Jesus, and our Blessed Mother, I extend most sincere condolences to his wife, Doreen, children Andrew, Gina, Erica, David, Andrew, and Matthew, grandchildren, siblings, other relatives, countless friends and colleagues. We pray that Deacon Tulloch will hear the words on that final day. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of thy master. Francis, rest in peace. This message from the Most Reverend and Honorable Charles Henry Dufour, Doctor of Divinity, Order of Jamaica, Commander of the Order of Distinction.
To God be the glory, to God be the glory, to God be the glory for the things he has done.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. All protocols observed in the interest of time. When Nicole and Janice Allen first asked me to do a tribute, I at first declined on the grounds that I found it to be very challenging to pay tribute to such a larger-than-life figure as Francis Tulloch. I surmise that I would have needed at least 2 hours. Nevertheless, I accepted the challenge and commenced my writing. Upon reaching some 25 foolscap pages and discovering that I had just barely begun to scratch the surface, I abandoned the idea and decided to speak extemporaneously about the man I knew as a lawyer, a politician, and a mentor. But then I was again called and requested to do the remembrance, which was even more challenging. What's more, I was told to limit my presentation to a mere 10 minutes, which I regarded to be impossible. I mean, it was like attempting to install a 1959 Cadillac engine in a 2022 Suzuki motor car. Nevertheless, ladies and gentlemen, I crave your indulgence as I attempt to navigate this journey, which I hope will not greatly exceed the time allotted to me. The life of Francis Anthony Tulloch was somewhat of a paradox. On the one hand, he was a very simple, humble, unassuming, regular guy, kind of like a next-door neighbor. However, on the other hand, he was an exceedingly successful lawyer and parliamentarian. He was a man for all times, a man of the people who never really lost the common touch, although he walked with kings, prime ministers, and presidents, as you have heard from my predecessors. Upon his first venture into formal education, he suffered a great misfortune. He was sent to St. George's College instead of Cornwall College. Both himself and Cornwall were poorer for this decision, but we forgive him because he had nothing to do with that. I apologize to Deacon Twaits and the other light blues in the congregation. Nevertheless, at George's, he excelled not only in academics, but in sports, as you have already heard. He represented the school in sunlight cricket. Not only that, he made the all-school sunlight team for 2 consecutive years. But there was something else that struck the young Francis at George's. He ran into one, Richard Holong, who is a well-known national figure in the Society of the Missionaries for the Poor. Father Holong had a distinct influence on the young Francis from that time. Francis also ran into several current successful businessmen. So upon leaving George's, he was ready to go into the world of business, politics, law, and of course, as you have heard, diplomacy and work in the Catholic Church. And it was from those early days that Francis had hoped to become a Catholic priest. Many of his contemporaries did not know that throughout his long life and various careers, he had a deep and abiding faith in the Catholic Church and its principles and objectives. Its preaching, particularly in the areas of love and respect for the poor and the downtrodden. Francis was guided by these principles throughout his life. In 1959, as a young man, he decided that he wanted to become a lawyer. He applied and was admitted to the Honorable Society of Lincoln's Inn in London. At that time, the best law school in the world. And again, no offense to my noble colleagues in the audience. I do recall that at that time, the Norman Manley Law School was not yet established. I say Francis was fortunate to go to that place because in this context, and his sojourn in London, he met one Lensley Wolfe, who later became his law partner at Tulloch, Wolfe and Ford on Union Street in Montego Bay in the 60s, which was one of the largest and most successful law firms in Western Jamaica. Lurie Ford, his other partner, predeceased both of them. But Francis continued to practice as a barrister during that period. In 1964, something significantly happened to Francis Tulloch, which probably changed the future course of his life. He departed from Jamaica for Nassau in the Bahamas, where he joined the law firm of the late, great Lyndon Pindling, who later became Sir Lyndon Pindling, and a former prime minister of the Bahamas. Between 1964 and 1969, Francis was his personal assistant, and it was there that Francis really developed his skills, not only as a lawyer, but as a politician, as he worked closely with Sir Lyndon in the fields of the vast Bahamian political landscape. But what is not also widely known, that Francis's sojourn in the Bahamas was facilitated by the late, great Jamaican barrister, the one and only Dudley Thompson, Queen's Counsel, who was a good friend of Sir Lyndon, where Thompson frequently visited to represent clients. Dudley Thompson most likely had some influence on the young Francis, upon Francis's return to Jamaica in 1969-70, he immediately established links with the People's National Party and began field work in St. James. Francis's political career really began in earnest in 1972, as you had heard, when he won the central St. James seat in a general election. His political opponent was the Jamaica Labour Party's late, great Edmund Anthony Hart, an experienced and well-oiled political figure in those days. Francis earned the moniker Little David at that time, as he beat the great Goliath, obtaining over 60% of the votes in that election. In 1976, he again successfully secured the West Central St. James constituency for the People's National Party and held that seat until 1980, when he took a sabbatical to concentrate on his law practice and to spend more time with his family and to recharge his political batteries. It was during this period of the 1980s that he invited Patience White and myself to join him in establishing the law firm Tulloch, Morgan & White. And it was during those years, ladies and gentlemen, that I had the opportunity to see Francis Tulloch up front and close, where I discovered the measure of the man who later became my mentor and friend. But the sabbatical did not last long. In fact, the truth is that he had never taken a break from political work, as our law office on St. James Street, across from the post office, was literally the constituency office. At times, it was impossible to know the difference between a constituent and a client. In 1993, Francis was called again to re-enter the political arena. But this time, he had migrated to Hanover, where a young doctor by the name of Horace Chang was giving the comrades over in Eastern Hanover a hard time. Tulloch challenged Horace Chang and was again successful in shipping the young doctor back to his medical practice. Tulloch held that seat until 1997. But although he was living in Hanover, he had to return to St. James in 97. As the more matured Dr. Horace Chang had now migrated to St. James, where he was again giving nightmares to the comrades over there. In the general election of 97, Tulloch dispatched Chang easily, thus becoming a 4-star general and being to date, if my memory serves me right, the only politician in Jamaica that has won 4 general elections in 4 different constituencies and 2 different parishes. Ladies and gentlemen, if I'm asked to summarize some of the main highlights of Francis Anthony Tulloch's multifaceted career, I would be compelled to mention the following events at the risk of boring you with some of these things which you have already heard from eminent statesman P.J. Patterson and Wickham McNeil. Francis was an outstanding member of parliament and a statesman. He was appointed parliamentary secretary in the Ministry of Labour and Social Security. He became Minister of State in the Ministry of Tourism. In 1997, he was appointed Minister of Tourism, as you have heard, in the administration of P.J. Patterson. But very few people remember that as far back as in 1977, he was elected a vice president of the People's National Party. And last but by no means least, his contribution to the upliftment and well-being of the poor and downtrodden across Jamaica, especially in the areas of housing and social entrepreneurship, is unmatched to date. His fingerprints and footprints can be seen in several areas of national life, especially in the West. Witness the housing developments in Catherine Hall and West Green and Westgate. Witness his contribution to Juta and Jekyll. Witness his contribution to the establishment of the Montego Bay Legal Aid Clinic, the Rent Board, the Stamp Office, and the Western Branch of the Supreme Court. Although Francis did not achieve his lifelong ambition of being a Catholic priest, he nevertheless added a jewel to his crown by becoming a deacon. Both his mother, who was raised by Catholic nuns, and his father, who was a famous bandmaster at Alpha Academy, would have been most pleased to see their son achieve this milestone. Francis also achieved another lifelong ambition, as you have heard from the Russian representative, to be a diplomat. It is not widely known that when Francis decided to go to the Bahamas to join Lyndon Pinling, he was approached by Sir Alexander Bustamante, who offered him a posting in London as a diplomat. But Francis almost accepted this appointment. But it was primarily because he wanted to take his retarded brother abroad for medical treatment. It was not until 2014, as you have heard, that he accepted the appointment as Consul General to Jamaica for the Russian Federation. During his later life, Francis's love for the law led him to accept the appointment as consultant to the law firm of Allen & Company, a position he held until his voluntary retirement from the legal profession, to concentrate more on heavenly matters. Although he could be devastating on the political platform, and he was a democratic socialist to the core, he was not a radical who saw politics as a means to an end. His brand of socialism was guided by Christian principles, which he advanced on behalf of the people. It is an open secret that during his final years, he became disgusted with the current political system, which he thought was hijacked by the rich to advance their own self-interest. Ladies and gentlemen, I close with two anecdotes, which I think epitomizes the person of Francis Anthony Tulloch. Some years ago, when Francis was active on the political hustings, Francis, his driver, and myself went to a function in the hills of St. James. The driver took home Francis. I was still in the vehicle. He dropped me home afterwards. But Francis arrived home only in his socks, his underpants, and his merino. No shoes, no clothes. Not wanting his then wife, Audrey, to see him in that state, he rushed into the bathroom and locked the door, not knowing that Audrey was awaiting his arrival. Audrey rushed to the door, the front door, and said, "Shot!" That's long shot. Some of you in the audience may know who that is. I was with him up to last night at Henry McCurdy's place where we had a wake. "Shot, Clayton. Are we going to take my husband? Where do you come from?" No answer. Shot said, "Ask your husband. Clayton, where do you come from? Where are you coming from with my husband like this?" "Ask your husband." She ran to the door, bathroom door. Francis, open the door, open the door. "You okay?" We heard a little voice coming from the bathroom. "Me meet one man who needed them more than me, so me give him them." On another occasion, at Tulloch, Morgan and White, well, on several occasions, I should say. Remember, I told you the office was more like a constituency office rather than a law office, or both. Several times, constituents came there, and we noticed that Francis couldn't come out of his office. One morning he came out of his office with his empty wallet in his hand and said to patients and me, "You don't have no money, can't lend me?" We said, we were young lawyers, we said, "We don't have much money, sir. What you want it for?" The boy, man out there wants some money for buy something. We emptied our wallets and we gave it to him. Of course, we were never repaid, and neither did we expect to get repaid. I mention those two incidents because it shows you the measure of the man, the type of man he was. He was generous to a fault. He could not say no. Ladies and gentlemen, my brothers and sisters, on behalf of the legal fraternity, myself, family, and the wider community he served, I offer to Doreen, Tony, Gina, David, Andrew, Matthew, and Erica, and the wider Tulloch family, our deep condolences. We thank you for sharing with us the life of Francis. May his soul rest in peace and life perpetual shine upon him. I thank you.
going home. I am going home. Going home. Going home. I am going home.
Are telling the glory of God. Please remain standing.
The heavens are telling the glory of God, and all creation is shouting for joy. Come dance in the forest, come play in the field, and sing, sing to the glory. Praise for the sun, the bringer of day. He carries the light of the Lord in his rays. The moon and the stars who light up the way unto your throne. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and all creation is shouting for joy. Come dance in the forest. Glory of the Lord. Praise for the wind that blows through the trees, the sea's mighty storms, the gentlest breeze. They blow where they will, they blow where they please, to please the Lord. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and all creation is shouting for joy. In the forest, and play in the field, and sing, sing to the glory of the Lord. Praise for the rain that waters our fields and blesses our crops, so all the earth is from death unto life. Her mystery revealed springs forth with joy. For the fire who gives us his light, the warmth of the sun. things of you. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and all creation is shouting for joy. Fountains in the forest come play in the field, and sing, sing to the glory of the Lord.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with
your spirit. My dear sisters and brothers, as we gather here today to give God thanks for the life of our brother Francis, we pause now and we give God thanks for bringing us here together. And as we come together today, we know that in his presence there is fullness of joy. And we come to obtain that joy today, that we can continue our journey. And so we say, I confess to Almighty God,
and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned
in my thoughts and in my words,
in what I have done and what I have failed to do, and
through my faults, through my fault, through my most grievous faults. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and me to the Lord our God.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us of our sins, and bring us eternal life.
Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. O Lord God, heaven and King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten. Receive our prayer. You who sit at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you only are holy, you only are Lord, you only, O Jesus Christ, are most high. Together with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father, in the glory.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, O merciful God, a share eternal happiness to the soul of our brother, your servant, Deacon Francis Tuller, on whom you bestow the gift of ministering in your church, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, everyone. I'm here to read the first lesson on behalf of our Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Andrew Holness, Prime Minister of Jamaica. But let me first extend on his behalf condolences to Mrs. Tulloch, the children, and members of the immediate family. Thank you. Reading from the Book of Wisdom, chapter 3, beginning at verse 1. But the souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and in their departure was thought to be a disaster. And they are going from us to be their destruction, but they are at peace. For though in the sight of others they were punished, their hope is full of immortality. Having been disciplined a little, they will receive great good, because God tested them and found them worthy of themselves. Like gold in furnace, he tried them, and like sacrificial burnt offering, he accepted them. In time of their visitation, they will shine forth and will run like sparks through the stubbles. They will govern nations and rule over peoples, and the Lord will reign over them forever. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love. Because of grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect. The word of the Lord. Thank you very much.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie. In pastures green he leadeth me, the quiet waters by. He liveth, he liveth, he liveth, he liveth. Restore again, and me to walk doth make. Within the paths of righteousness, he for his own name's sake. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, he lives, he lives. He lives within my heart.
Yea, though I walk in death's dark vale, yet will I fear no ill. For thou art with me, and thy rod and staff me comfort still. He lives, he lives, he lives. But he lives within my heart.
My table thou hast furnished in presence of my foes. My head thou dost with oil anoint, and my cup overflows. He lives. He lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, he lives,
He lives. He lives within my heart. Goodness and mercy all my life shall surely follow me, and in God's house forevermore my dwelling place shall be. He lives, he lives, he lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, he lives, he lives, he lives within my
reading on behalf of the leader of the opposition, Mr. Mark Golin. Brethren, none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord of the dead and of the living. We shall all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So each of us shall give account of himself to God. The word of the Lord.
Alle, alle, alle. No one comes to the Father except through me.
Alle,
alle, alle, alle, alle. Alleluia,
alle, alle, alle. Alleluia, alle, alle, alle.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, when the Son of Man comes in his glory escorted by all the angels of heaven. He will sit upon his royal throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him. Then he will separate them into two groups, as a shepherd separates sheep from goats. The sheep he will place on his right hand, the goats on his left. The king will say to those on the right, "Come, you have my father's blessings. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. I was ill, and you comforted me. In prison, and you came to visit me." Then the just will ask him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? Or see you thirsty and give you drink? When did we welcome you away from home or clothe you in your nakedness? When did we visit you when you were ill or in prison?" The king answered them, "I assure you, as often as you did it for one of my least brothers, you did it for me." Then he will say to those on the left, "Out of my sight, you condemned, into that everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was away from home, and you gave me no welcome. Naked, and you gave me no clothing. I was ill and in prison, and you did not come to comfort me." Then they in turn will ask, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or away from home, or naked, or ill, or in prison, and not attend to you in your needs?" He will answer them, "I assure you, as often as you neglected to do it for one of the least ones, you neglected to do it for me." These will go off to eternal punishment, and the just to eternal life. The gospel of the Lord.
That we did ever see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you nothing to drink? Then the king will reply, "When you did this to the least of my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me." Words taken from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 26, just read. Let us pray. Cleanse our hearts and lips, Almighty God, as you cleanse the lips of your prophet Isaiah with a burning coal, so that your truth may be spoken and our spirits inflamed by your word. Amen. Sir, when did we ever see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you anything to drink? This homily is about life, Your life, my life, inspired by faith. Our life as Jamaicans, as human persons, inspired by faith. And it's a story about Francis's life too. But first, some memories. Clayton has put me in my position already. But I need to tell you, when it came to the girls, I had no chance when Francis was around. Being 2 years ahead of me at St. George's, remember he was in the class of people like Richard Hulong, Barry Chavans, Lee Issa, Bobby Marsh. Every time I, a little scrawny white boy, tried to lyrics a pretty alpha girl at the bus stop on South Camp Road, or at Champs or Manning Cup at Sabina, this tall, dark guy with his sly smile and the sexy drawl would appear, and my case would be lost. It was only years after Francis had moved on that I could finally get through. And it was just as bad when it came to cricket. Despite being terribly short-sighted, I fancied myself as a wicket-keeper. But after conceding 12 byes in one over, Francis's laconic and compassionate advice after I caused his team to lose a game was, "Ronnie, I think you would do better as a scorer." At least he never told me to be the water boy. But from early days, he would defend the lowly, you know. I recall a number of us trying out for the school choir. Trevor Monroe and I were small boys whose fathers insisted we wear short pants, and our voices had not changed. And the priest in charge of the choir wanted us to sing soprano. But Francis would have none of it. "Father, you can't do that to these youth. They are not picnic, they are growing boys." I think all three of us got kicked out of the choir for insubordination. He could have been my lawyer from then. Later, he and Howard Hamilton were in a case together, and they indulgently gave me, a broke pocket young barrister, some pleadings to settle. Well, whatever I did was hardly material, because these two sharp-witted, sweet-mouthed lawyers could prevail in the worst case, even before the prickly Judge Carey, remember him? The terror of Miss Groves, who wanted to sentence people to death for bad words. And even Mr. Justice Parnell. "Mr. Tulloch, your submissions are very good. Judgment for your client." Criticism, disappointment, and failure in professional, political, and personal life, there were. But Francis's optimistic spirit never quailed. The grace, and yes, it is a grace, of his self-deprecating humor and his winning personality usually prevailed. Like his favorite minstrel, Neil Diamond sang, "Hurt runs off my shoulders." Jesus' description of what constitutes righteousness, essentially the feeding and the caring of others, is stark and compelling for a nation lurching towards its 60th birthday. And as we gather to remember a man whose deepest conviction and life purpose was that the kingdom of God is the flourishing of humankind. The kingdom of God is the flourishing of humankind. For it will be when all humanity rise to their divine potential that God's will will have been done on earth as it is in heaven, and his kingdom will have come. Christianity is deeply countercultural. The dominant ethic in our land and elsewhere now is that pursuing self-interest and personal advancement are the real reasons to live, the sources of happiness, the icons of success. Many of us distort liberty to justify selfishness and idolatry. We make ourselves, our bodies, our positions, and our possessions to be our gods. Shenesia, one of the most popular dancehall artists, is quoted as saying, "Whatever I want to do, I do it. People should be free in their own life. I'm not standing for things," I suppose she means that a previous generation did. "I'm not standing for the things that they stood for." I ask you, can we build a wholesome society on the basis of unbridled individualism and low trust? And what can be the foundation of trust other than a shared meaning and purpose? I noted carefully and with admiration that the Prime Minister at a church service last Sunday acknowledged just that, that trust has to be built upon a shared vision of life and the future, a belief in others that they will not act opportunistically, but in accord with some social compact. Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life, whose presence Francis Tulloch sought in all of his weakness to incarnate, is a countersign to this mad gathering recourse to selfishness and life denial. The precepts which Francis learned from his principal middle-class family in Vineyard Town, from the Jesuits at St. George's, in the canons of human rights and jurisprudence, which were the kernel of his legal training. These were to fashion a life of service, to make him who St. Ignatius described as a man for others, inspired by faith. And we allow dilution of that quality of moral education in our schools, on our streets, and in our homes. We allow that nowadays at our irredeemable personal and national peril. It is the most crucial and the least attended to element of educational transformation. It is no use if we have all the degrees and all of the academic skills and we behave as Lego beasts. Francis Tulloch was a nationalist. He could have been successful in the Bahamas or anywhere else, but this land and its people were his passion. He came of age when the nation was birthing, came of age professionally. It was a wonderful time of unlimited possibilities and promise. Ardent nationalism, love of one's nation, devotion to one's country is a Christian virtue. And we must worry that the self-giving nation lovers seem to be a declining breed, as so many of us destroy ourselves on the altar of crabbed self-interest. Devotion to equality of opportunity, which is the God-ordained and Jesus-affirmed antidote to the evil of class and racial discrimination. Francis deepened and shared this conviction with the mentors of his political persuasion, especially Michael Manley, Howard Cook, Upton Robotham, Glover Allen, Cecil Donaldson, and more, many, many more, too numerous to name. I ask us today, do we still proclaim and strive for those ideals in our political culture, our business practices, and yes, in our most intimate relationships? Or is Darwin's inexorable law of survival of the fittest what we are settling for? I believe God has destined this people, this land, for greater things. We can build a society inspired by faith, with gospel values informing every line in the national budget, every policy decision, and every personal choice. Christian faith is not for the margins of life. Jesus is crying out to us today, "I am hungry." Francis tried to respond by making sure that the dispossessed had land titles so enough food could grow. He supported a spiritual ethic and a political system that provides for all, but especially for the weakest and the most vulnerable. One that favors Lazarus over Dives. Tell me, church, what is the philosophy which forms the foundation of our laws, our governance and social construct in Jamaica? The pandemic has aggravated the rape of predatory capitalism and showed up its uncaring and authoritarian character. Equally, godless hyper-individualism and moral relativism have discredited ideologies of the left and rendered them no less oppressive and cruel than the system which they sought to supersede. There is another path. Western civilization, in its essence, is founded on Judeo-Christian principles. And when the greed and racism of colonialism mangled and overturned those principles in practice, our people survived the crucifixion of slavery by creating and crafting a Creole culture, still in the making, wrought on the hard anvils of effort, sacrifice, and forgiveness. This is God working among us, a society founded on the religious conviction of the worth and dignity of every human person from conception to natural death. A system of laws and lives promoting opportunity, not for all of us to be the same, but neither for some to flourish and others to semi-starve on minimum wage and less. A political ethic where the supreme privilege of wealth and power is to serve, to lift, and to enable, not to splurge and engorge while others pick the garbage at retirement. What a happy Jamaica it would be this August morning if all of us use our money, our influence, our authority, and strength of our minds and bodies to enable, not to disable, our brothers and sisters. That's the economics, the politics, and the social order which Francis Tulloch yearned for. Jesus calls out, "I am thirsty," not for drink or substances which are going to sick our bodies or addle our minds, but for the good, clean water at Lethe, and for the clean, soul-inspiring, refreshing vibes of our culture. You can't slake people's thirst with the toxic banality of Juke Jacqueline, Boom Bayai, or Wine Punnett Gal. It is productive, rewarding work that the people of St. James and of East Hanover need, not scratch and win and scamming. Francis, the Member of Parliament and the Minister, knew that you can't build loving relationships, a sustainable tourist industry, on hedonism and slackness. Those are shifting sands. Wokeism and cancel culture are perversions of the freedom to love to which God calls all of us. Being a Christian didn't make Francis a prude or a killjoy. Trust in God and his son Jesus calls us to be sensitive, loving people, conscious of the dignity of ourselves and each other, simply living so that others can simply live. Simply living so that others can simply live. Getting to the heart of each other. rather than wallowing in the isms and schisms of the social and political divides of our past and present. While, as the Rastaman says, Jah kingdom gone to waste. But make no mistake, please allow me the frankness of this occasion to say that the antagonistic positions which some of us die-hearted comrades and laborites take are not advancing the 2030 mission. Entrenched in our own truths and drunk with the brap-brap and the forwards that we get from our own echo chambers, we often end up becoming unconscious prisoners of ourselves, so projecting our own confusions and hubris and dissatisfactions into every situation. We can't even agree to sit down and talk about the most elemental and important things, that walking together becomes almost impossible. We cannot go on like this. Francis, by contrast, maintained good relations with people of whatever political persuasion or none. He was comfortable and accepted in the Ritz or on Railway Lane. He was not a tribalist. He knew that no one side can solve the nation's intractable problems alone, and he longed for more real, practical, not mouthwater, unity, both in the politics and in the religious sphere. I ask us today on his memorial, are we of the same mind? Is money power, state power, or church exceptionalism so seductive that we want to hug it up, even when we can't manage and are hurting others? That is not Jesus' way. His new way, the only hope for this nation, is to respect everyone, to recognize that worth comes not from one's wealth, nor how you run down national honors maybe, not when we feel that if we change the color of our skin, wear somebody else's hair, or debase modesty by thinking that fashion and popularity means taking off most of your clothes in the streets. Reverend Astor Carlyle, the great preacher at the JLP Memorial Service last weekend, told us that social transformation and spiritual direction are being called upon to build for the ages. It's a long-term struggle, odyssey, pilgrimage that we are on. Barish Evans used to sing, revolution take a year or two. It's hard to correct spiritual and social decay, you know. But when you fret all night and you can't work next day, who feeds you? And what does that do for already abysmal low productivity? And when you pay big money to dress up with more feathers on your head than cover on your bottom, and you get on bad, be aware of the profound lesson that we are teaching the young ones who can't buy our school shoes and who yet we expect to display exemplary behavior. Jesus' life calls us to generosity of spirit. Francis could have made much more money if he had stayed out of politics and the church. Doreen, you must have had to hold on to some of whatever here, and now you would have given it all away. Instead, Francis followed the one who stretched out his innocent arms on a cross so that we might have abundant life here. And can we even dare to repeat the promise? Eternal life. You tell me, you know any better way to live? Any better way to construct and conform our society? Paul's injunction to the Romans in the second reading thunders through history to us in Montego Bay and confronts our systems of political economy. Paul says, none of us lives for oneself and no one dies for oneself. Why then do you judge your brother or sister and look down on them? For we shall all stand before the judgment of God. And as the wisdom reading reminds us, death is not annihilation. The preface to the Eucharist, soon to be pronounced, states the truth that in death, life is changed, not ended.
The frayed and wearied husk of Francis's body has been reduced to ashes. His spirit dwells strong, present yet unseen among us. Perhaps he's asking us right now, where are the virtues of good citizenship, of deep mutual respect, of self-restraint and self-sacrifice being taught to our children, made redolent in our media, being enfleshed in the lives of us, the parents, the teachers, the leaders, the guinea-gogs of Jamaican society? He tried in the schools, tried in the basic school at Cambridge. Where are we spreading that balm in our respective Gileads? Like many of us in political life, past and present, Francis became impatient and indeed disappointed with the narrow parameters of possibility to help his constituents. The lofty aspirations for service collide with the realities of budget, implementation difficulties, and yes, political favor. But there was a natural progression from the political theater to this altar of ultimate sacrifice and victory. Just as MP Francis understood the presence of Jesus Christ in the marketplaces of Charles Gordon in the Bay or George William Gordon House on Duke Street in town, so Deacon Francis would find Jesus among ordinary folk and spread his word at Sacred Heart Reading, St. Mary's Cambridge, and St. Agnes at Chester Castle. And it wasn't a step down for him. Being an ordained minister wasn't a retirement hobby. Same vineyard. There are not two kingdoms, one of Caesar and the other of God. Jesus is Lord of all. We don't come here to canonize Deacon Francis Tuller either. Like all of us, he must have had many faults. In the best of us, there is a sinner. In the worst of us, there is a saint. So thank God that his other name, God's other name, is mercy. Give thanks that before his passing, Francis received the Eucharist of God's real presence and the anointing of forgiveness. I believe it is well. It is well with his soul. And what else matters? Today we bless Doreen, Francis's family, friends, and caregivers for their commitment and faithful love in the most difficult moments. Think of it, each of us, for this is but a dress rehearsal for our own funeral, you know. Think of it, when you strip life of all pretensions and puppy show, it is faithfulness, relationships, steadfastness, forbearance, and sacrifice. These are the qualities that are as acutely needed in the context of human suffering, of aging, as they are for a nation in travail. Francis Tuller was a decent servant of his family, his people, and his church. His qualities deserve our emulation. His spirit now chants the familiar anthem of his conviction to give us hope and courage as we go forward. The words are a prayer. Those of you who know it, recite it with me. In steadfast assurance that God will look down and give us his blessings, our efforts to crown. Let's all be united to build by his grace a nobler Jamaica, a loftier race. Jamaica, arise. Let us live life inspired by faith. Amen.
I must have the Savior with me, for I dare not walk alone. I must feel his presence near me and his arms around me thrown. Then my soul shall fare no ill. Let him lead me where he will. I will go without a murmur, and his footsteps follow still.
I must have my Savior with me in the onward march of life, through the tempest and the sunshine, through the battle and the strife. Then my soul shall fear no evil. Let him lead me where he will. I will go without a murmur, and his footsteps follow
still. Let us stand now as we present our needs to the Lord. And our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer.
In baptism, Francis Anthony Tulloch received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. Let us pray to the Lord. Our brother Francis was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The family and friends of Francis seek comfort and consolation, heal their pain, and dispel the darkness and doubt that comes from grief. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Our brother Francis served God's people as a deacon of the church. Prepare a place for him in the kingdom whose coming he proclaimed. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our brother Francis. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your son's coming. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord God, give us peace and heal our soul. Hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voice of your people, whose life are purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in the kingdom. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
At this time, we'll take a collection up, which will go towards the renovation funds here at the cathedral and also for the St. Mary Early Childhood Education Center, which our Deacon Francis really worked hard to put together. So please, thank you for your generation, for your generous generation.
Amen. Please be seated.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall
shall sound and time shall be no more.
When the time of day, the eternal day, and
the ghost will gather on the other shore, and the road is called up yonder.
I'll be there. When the road is called up yonder, when the road is called up yonder,
when the road is called up yonder,
when the road is called up yonder,
on the bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share. Oh, when the chosen ones shall gather in their home beyond the sky, and the roll is called of yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll, is called up yonder,
is called up yonder, when the
roll,
is called up yonder,
is called up yonder,
when the
roll,
is called up yonder,
when the roll, is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Let us lay before the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the road is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the road is called up yonder,
when the road
is called up yonder,
when the road
is called up yonder,
shall sound and time shall be no more. When the morning breaks eternal night and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll,
take the bread we offer you.
you offer us eternal life.
Father, Lord, you gave us Jesus Christ.
Rise again, for I know He is the living East of life, and I know that life will rise again.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the heart and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Be gracious, O Lord, to Francis, your servant and deacon, for those salvation we offer for the sacrifice, that as the flesh, as he ministered into Christ, your Son, so may he raise up the faithful servant to everlasting glory through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for in through your own fault we perish, but by your compassion you grant us grace. When seized by death and according to your sin, we are redeemed through the Christ's great victory, and with him called back into life. And so with the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth, and before your majesty, without end we acclaim.
Hosanna, 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 Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God, God of hosts. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, O Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and work of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather people to yourself. So from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, gracious to make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, so that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, O Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessings, and broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
And drink this cup. We proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look with prayer upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim in whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we were nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal, may he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for your unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, your servant Francis, our Pope, and Basil, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own.
Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Grace us to grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we are always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sin, but on the feet of your church, and grace us to grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Peace, peace, peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. My brothers and sisters, behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. comes to me shall not hunger. He who believes in me shall not thirst. No one can come to me unless the Father draws him, and I will raise him up, and I will raise him up, and I will raise him up on that last day. The bread that is my flesh for the life of the world, and he who eats of this bread, he shall live forever, he shall live forever, and I will raise him.
Yeah.
world so dark and dread, from the wily snares of Satan, shield me, Mother, Mother dear. Dearest Mother, tell my Jesus how I love him fond and true. And oh Mary, dearest Mother, tell him I belong to
Jesus judges. Answer for me when he asks how I spent so many moments, how perform so many tasks. Mary, oh my dearest mom,
Mother, tell my Jesus how I love him fond and true. And oh Mary, dearest
let us pray. Replenish with these sacred gifts, we humbly entreat you, O Lord, graciously to grant you the sacrifice that your servant, our brother Francis, whom you have called to be among those who serve your church, once free from bonds of death, may receive a share with those who have ministered well, and enter into the joy. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing.
And may Almighty God bless you all now. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Our celebration has ended. Go forth in the peace of Christ, loving and serve the Lord.
Thanks.
Please be seated.
Last night I lay asleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang.
Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King.
And then me thought my dream was changed. The streets no longer ran. Hush were the glad Hosanna, the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery. The morn was cold and chill, as a shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As a shadow a cross arose upon a lonely hill. Jerusalem,
Jerusalem, hark how the angels sing. Once again, the scene was changed. New earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets. The gates were open wide.
Onward might enter, and no one was denied.
No need of moon or stars by night, or sun to shine by day.
It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away.
It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. Please sing with us.
Jerusalem,
sing, sing, for the night is o'er.
Please stand for the national anthem. Eternal Father, bless the land, guide us with thy mighty hand, keep us free from evil powers, be our light through countless hours. Jamaica.